Yeah. So now it is clearly visible, correct?
Yeah, yes.
Okay.
Okay, so it's your time, you can start. I'm muting myself. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So as I was saying that it is most important to do the most important things. So the most important thing here is to start with the disclaimer. So we must understand the meaning of disclaimer. And this is legally as well as intellectually, this is very, very important to understand and read. I'm sure you are aware of it, but still, I'll give you 30 seconds to read this disclaimer. Okay, done. So this is about me, and I don't want to talk because this was a slide which was inserted here. And let us go to next slide. I think there is. So today we are going to talk about a centralized cold store. And see, this is not a rocket science, or I'm not going to talk something which is from moon and nobody has ever talked it, or nobody has ever explained it, but I will share this from my perspective. The way I have worked and the way I have learned the things, and the way my mentors have taught the few things. So I'll just share my ideas. I'll just share whatever I have learned till today. So about me, I was born and brought up in India. Born in Himachal, brought up in Delhi, studied in Kerala. And from last almost 18 years, I'm in Dubai. I work with the companies like Maikawa, Gia, Guttner, etc. And my experience was, I started working with the design department, and then I went into project management. And finally, I was in project sales. And last part of my career, I was into component selling. When we say component selling, so it was only Guttner products, right? Now today we are like, when I was with my second job, so we've been interacting with mostly investors. So investor is always coming up with a bare land. So he is always coming to you and ask you that I want to set up a cold store. So please help me. For an engineer, a designer, or a project sales guy, or a project management person, it is very, very awkward situation. I mean, first time that why he is coming to me. I know about refrigeration. How would I know about setting up a cold store? But one thing I learned, if we know backward and forward integration of cold chain management, then it is easy for us to design and select or sell the cold store. So today we are just going to do a mock also. For example, a customer coming to us and he says that he is having a land around 70 meter into 45 meter. So he want us to set up a cold store. And this is the situation I have come across many time, long back, maybe 15 years back. And that time I was, I had no idea what to do, but I have learned over the time. An investor will come and give you some strange data. For example, he'll say, I want to store fruits. Then he will say he want to also store vegetable. Then he'll say garlic. Then he says, even I would like to include frozen products, vegetables, ice cream, chocolate, spices, dry fruit. And at the end, he says, why don't you design a multiple commodity cold store for me? So this is very, very strange situation for any designer or a project salesperson or anybody who's involved into or a stakeholder in this. So what you will do? So that time, the first thing comes to my mind was, I went to my boss and I told him, sir, it is better we should not entertain this person because he does not know what he wants to do. But my boss told me, just go ahead and try to learn. Yeah. So we try to learn. So for example, that particular land, we can, based on his input, we can have 6 rooms, a corridor, and a loading unloading area. And based on his inputs, we have decided that we will have a cold store which will work from 0 degrees Celsius to minus 20 degrees. This is a challenge.
This is a challenge, of course.
I think somebody has unmuted himself and his speaker is on because there is a reverberation and echo. Now, these are 6 rooms which will be multiple commodity storage where we have product storage from plus 10 degrees Celsius to minus 20 degrees Celsius, which is normal distribution center, say. So we have 6 rooms, we have a corridor, we have staff and technician room, we have a machinery room, and we have decided height of cold store around 6.5. Even though this height is very, very strange in present times because the land is becoming so costly, so people would like to go for at least 10 meter height. Yeah, this is the trend which is going on in centralized cold store around this world. Because if you have a 16 to 70 meter square area, so you can go higher, but you can't go wider. So people try to go higher. Then we have a marshalling area. Some call it loading, unloading area. Some call it marshalling area. And then we have a forklift charging area. And most of these areas are temperature controlled. I think my presentation also got stuck somewhere. I don't know why. So first thing we do here is the load calculation. Now load calculation is also a challenging part. Why? Because there are different commodities and there are different parameters you need to maintain. For example, once I've been told by one of my customer, he was having 20 rooms. And he wanted all the 20 rooms working from plus 10 degrees Celsius to minus 28 degrees Celsius. Plus one room he wanted to have as an all-rounder room, which you may say as a universal room. And why we call it universal room? Because that room was designed and should be designed with the relative humidity from plus 40 to 95. And temperature from plus 10 to minus 20. And air volumes as low as possible to as high as possible for pre-cooling. So first step in any load calculation is that you should understand what are the commodities you have. Yeah, I am getting this window pop up again and again, and as I said, I have waiting room. Too many people, I think they are waiting to join, and they are. Now, the first thing is which is very normal, and it is a transmission load. And this I have made this load calculation. It is a chapter in ASHRAE 2018 Refrigeration Handbook. So chapter 14, 24, if you go, I would suggest all the young engineers or any experienced engineers or anybody, you must have seen many programs. You know, program from X company, Y company, all the programs are reputed. But I always trust the calculation which are done based on Ashrae chapter 24. And this has got excellent, excellent way of explaining how to calculate the load. So first, you are calculating transmission load. Transmission load is what? It is thermal energy transferred from the walls, ceiling, or roof, and even from the floor. And you know, some of the cases it can be as low as 5% of the load. In fact, it can go up to 20% of the load. And the second most important component of any load is product load. So product load, when you do, you must understand what product is there. For example, if you have an apple, your load will be different. And your room will be entirely different with respect to humidity, temperature, and air circulation. But if you have a cheese or you have a milk chocolate, your room will be totally different and your product load will be entirely different. So product load, also you have three stages. First stage, where you remove your latent load, where you are bringing a product from certain temperature to certain temperature. And the second stage is where you are removing the latent heat from the product, which means you are changing the phase of the product and you are freezing the product. And the third important phase is when you come below freezing stage and you try to bring down the product temperature from freezing temperature lower down to the core temperature of maybe minus 18, minus 20, or minus 25, depending upon. So here you can see, first is your cooling load, which takes some time. But the freezing load, if you see, it takes maximum time because the compressor is working hard to remove the latent heat of freezing, right? And then you further cool it, and then it is you get a frozen product. Once product is fresh or it is a frozen, depending upon that, you decide what is the storage area. And then you have an internal load, which is forklifts, processing machine, people, and other electrical loads. Yes, the fourth one is the most important load, is infiltration load. See, as a project salesperson or as a designer or as a component salesperson, I have experienced that this load has been ignored by many people and their bills are coming very high. So this is a load which can even go up to 50 to 60% of the load. For example, if you have a cold store at the port, your load may go up to 50%. Yes, but if you are a distribution center with nice loading dock and a corridor where you are able to maintain and kill the relative humidity. I would request.
Please mute. Galaxy is the phone. Please mute. Please all request to mute.
Sir, no PPT is visible here.
No PPT visible?
Yes, sir. No PPT is visible at my end. Is there an issue with everybody or any particular?
Just let me know if everyone able to see.
Just it, screen is blank and it is written Arun Kumar Bhatti has started the screen sharing. Nothing. No PPT.
There also the PPT is not visible.
It is visible.
So you kindly ask everyone to check.
Yeah. No, it is okay. I had the same problem. You please restart your computer.
Only blank it is coming. Only it is written Arun Kumar Bhatti has started the screen sharing.
Yes, I had the same problem. I restarted and it is working fine.
Please restart, then everyone can see. Please restart.
So you want me to?
No. I mean to say the person who is not able to see, he should restart.
Yeah, exactly.
No, sir. I have left the meeting and again I have logged in again. The same problem is there. I have done
no,
it.
No, you have to restart the computer. Same thing I had.
Problem. Okay, sir. Please check at your end. Arun, sir. We can continue.
If you have any problem regarding presentation or my voice, please address your question to me. I believe that you may be getting blank screen because of internet speed. This may be the first reason, or maybe loading of your software. That may be another problem. RAM, because it the speed of your RAM. I don't know what is other reason, because these are the two things I learned in last 2 months doing a lot of sessions. Yeah. So everybody else is able to see the screen.
Yeah, we can see. You can continue. The one who is having some issues, please, I request you to please restart your system and join back. So, Mr. Arun, you can continue.
Yeah. So the infiltration load is most important, because if you see the screen, if your door is opening and you are getting a high humidity here, it creates a frost. And that creates lot of load and power consumption in defrosting and other. And you really face high electricity bills. I think I'm getting this pop up again and again. Admit. Now the last in load calculation, we have the diversity. For example, the room we had, I did some sample calculations here for this room number 5 at the corner, because this room is exposed to sunlight from two sides and roof. Sorry. So transmission load here as a chiller application is 7 kilowatt, as a freezer application is 11 kilowatt. So as the product load, which is 9.5 kilowatt and 2 kilowatt. An internal load, which is almost same here. Yeah. And and load for when we are designing this as a multiple commodity storage room, and load as a chiller is 31 kilowatt and load as a freezer is around 29 kilowatt. Now there is another component which we call diversity. Diversity is very, very important component or very, very important point when you have say 10 or more rooms. Then we have to make an assumption that all the calculation we have done is for peak load calculation, peak load for the cold store. And never ever any cold room runs at a peak load. Because once you start filling, because traffic at the cold store in such a way that you have 6 or 3 or 4 docking stations. So not every time all the docking stations are full. So at a time you get 1, 2, or 3 containers, and you fill container one by one. So considering that, you have to take diversity, which can be from 10% to 50%. So in this case, we have taken say 15% diversity. Now, once our load calculations are done, we go and select the compressors. Yeah, so compressor can be screw compressor, piston compressor, single stage compressor, compound compressor, now based on our calculation and the cold store requirement, the most important and the key point here is what evaporators you are going to have. Because after compressor, because based on load calculation, you will decide your compressor. Based on your diversity, you decide your compressor. But our evaporators are always, always should be equivalent to the load of the room. And they should never be equivalent to the diversity of the. For example, if we have 10 rooms, each room is 20 kilowatts, so 200 kilowatt will not be a compressor capacity. So with the diversity, we may be having 175 to 180 kilowatt centralized compressor capacity. But the evaporator should be at 100% load. Now, when we select evaporators, the most important thing is we have multi-commodity cold store. So what we have to take into consideration is what type of evaporator should be there, what capacity, what refrigerant, what air volume, what humidity, what defrost cycle we are going to have, and how much air throw we are planning to have, and what material of construction. And at the end, of course, the most important, what accessories, what add-ons we are going to have. Now, I think again I'm getting some, there are pop-up because of. Now, you know, you have ceiling mounted evaporators, you have floor mounted evaporators, you have a dual discharge, you have single discharge, but the most important thing is how do you select them? You select based on refrigerant, you select based on the temperatures, you select based on the allow pressures requirements and other design demand. For example, you may have a requirement of pre-cooling room where you are looking for 400 or 500 Pascal fans. So you can't go with a propeller fans. So you must choose axial fans. Yeah. Now, the first point here we are going to discuss is airflow. Airflow or air volume, you can, in thumb rule, whatever I have learned. So these are the circulation rates. If you see left of your screen, so normal freezer holding rooms, you have a circulation rate to from 6 circulations to 15 circulation, and chiller with holding is considered to be 10 to 25 circulations, and chiller with cooling, you will always have minimum 25 circulation to maximum 40 circulations. Now in this particular case, our room volume is 1308.2 meter cube. You remember at the beginning we had a room dimensions. So we are taking that only as an example. So for freezer operation, I must have my evaporator air volume circulation as 19,600 meter cube per hour. And if we have chiller operation, then we must have around 32,000 meter cube per hour volume. Now the trick is, because this room should be designed for dual operation, it should work as a chiller and it should work as a freezer. So what I will choose two different evaporators, each doing around 19,000 and both together doing 38,000 air circulation. Of course, considering all other parameters into the mind. We cannot ignore other parameters, which we will. And another thing I would like to request you, if you have any questions in between, you can always ask me. I will try to, you know, answer them in between. Otherwise, later on, we may be missing some question. So once you know that you have a storage of apples, so you need a chiller around 35,000 meter cube per hour. And if you have a dry stores, so you may have say around 20,000 meter cube per hour. So it is very important for us to understand what product and how do we now the second important point in air cooler or air evaporator selection is air through. There are a lot of definitions about air through and people try to explain it in a different manner. But how do I explain in my trainings is, I think being during my childhood, I used to visit my village and we used to play in a pond that we used to throw the stones. Yeah. And as a kid, we used to compete with each other whose stone will go how far. So air throw is also the similar phenomena. Yeah. So air throw, where we see it is a characteristic of fan power and fan blade. Now fan blade and fan motor is having a power to blow or to throw the air from one end of the room to another end. So if this room can be 10 meter, this room can be as, you know, lengthy as 100 meters. Yeah. The longest, single fan air throw we have done in a cold store, which was around 80 meter long. And we have used evaporator at one end and we were throwing the air up to 80 meter. Yeah. But there are many ways you can do opposite side of evaporator that will come in a later stage. So as a product description, you can see as product as a recipient, if the definition of air throw is your evaporator is at the one end of the cold store, and if product is standing at the opposite end, so product should be able to feel the air, or air should be able to go through that product and recirculate or circulate through that by taking away the heat of the product or able to cool the product. So this is the most important point here. Always remember, being a childhood, if you have thrown the stone or you have applied shot puts, or so air throw is similar phenomena like this. So in sketch you can see evaporator is fitted at this end. So air throw is a phenomena where you are making sure that air is reaching to the wall, and this wall, the product at the end of the wall should be able to receive the air. Now air throw, there is a formula which I think you can check on internet. It is not what I have invented. Air throw is T into V square into half 1.2 divided by density of air. So turbulence factor and phase velocity and density. So this is the way we are able to achieve the air throw calculations. Now another important thing is a room temperature. So this is a magic which I have learned when I was kid in refrigeration, and we go to many customers. As a designer, we were supporting our salespeople, and when I become salesman, so I was feeling this phenomena too much. For example, a competition has given you offer which says that his evaporator is able to generate -3 degree room. And I have also done the same thing, but my prices are 15% to 25% costly than the competition. So I always go back to my mentor, and I used to ask him, sir, what should I do? So then he explained me that there is temperature is a phenomena which is recorded and presented. So how do you sense this temperature? That is the most important thing. Are you sensing this temperature somewhere in the room, or you are sensing this just in opposite to evaporator, or you are sensing this air temperature from the inlet of the evaporator? So all these points are very important, and these points make sure that you are giving right product. These points ensure that you are giving a suitable product, or you are cheating your customer. So let's see. So this is the first scenario. What was my calculation? Because I was 15 to 25% costly. So my room temperature was minus 20 degrees Celsius. So what I was calculating? I was calculating air on temperature at minus 20 degrees Celsius. So what is air on temperature? The return air which is coming after touching the product and after complete the circulation of the room through the product, and it will come back goes through your fins before entering the evaporator. It should show that, it should sense that it is minus 20 degrees Celsius. So that was my, that was my calculation to do minus 20 degree room temperature. So that is the way I was designing my evaporator. Of course, there were reason behind it. Now how competition was doing? What he was taking? He was taking the sensor, he was placing somewhere in the middle of the room, right? Or somewhere here. So when you sense it here, so it was always show that it is minus 20 degree, because he was taking average temperature. So when you get minus 18 degrees Celsius compared to scenario number first at the inlet, your outlet will be around minus 20 degrees Celsius, assuming, and I assume the design is such that there is minus 3 to minus 4 degree temperature drop in evaporator coil. And this, when you are sensing it here, it is minus 20 degrees Celsius. So in scenario 2, the coil was at least 15 to 20% smaller. And that was the reason my competition was able to give cheaper prices. And this was a good learning for me. And I think this is the one thing which we should always keep in mind, that ultimately we must understand what is the room temperature criteria your competition is considering. Because otherwise he will admit you, he will make sure that you have no space to move. And as an investor, you know, most of the investors, they think that they are very smart. Yeah, this is my experience. Okay, I'm sharing with you. No investor is smarter than engineers, because engineers knows better. An investor knows how to make money. Engineers knows how to design cold store. So whatever smart, whatever Einstein an investor is, he cannot be smarter than a design engineer. And design engineer can always play with the specification. So I always suggest, try to have apple to apple comparison. Yeah. And try to have apple to apple comparison from a neutral authority. And in this case, you can see that again, I get some pop-ups. In this scenario, you can see that my competition had a smaller evaporators. And so I was able to explain it to my buyer, and he was very happy, and I was able to build trust in him, and he bought the complete project from me. So it is important for us to educate our customers also. that what they are buying, why my product is costly and why competition product is. Let me go. Yes. Now the placement of air coolers. So placement of air coolers, you have a good cooler, you have a nice cooler, you have designed it very nice, you have bought the best quality evaporator or air cooler, and you make sure that you are buying say DT1, you make sure that your everything is correct. But if you are not able to place this cooler properly, most of your money goes wasted. So as an investor, you have to be careful. As a designer, you have to be very, very careful. For example, if you see here, this evaporator is placed. This is a ceiling mounted single discharge evaporator. So when this evaporator is throwing air in this direction, so there is a ceiling. There is some protruding part in the ceiling. It may be RCC structure or any turbulence or any obstruction. So this air, air is a very stupid. Air, if you give any turbulence to air, it will change the direction because it is a fluid, right? So once it gets any obstruction here, so it changes its way, and some of the air goes further and it changes its way, and then further it changes its way. So like that, we even though our air cooler is selected with best of the air throw, best of the air circulation, and best of the specification, but if we are not placing it correctly, your effort goes wasted and your investment goes wasted. And what you get at the end? High electricity bills for least cooling effect. And in cold store, you have 90% of your cost is electricity. So if you are paying electricity for free, you are not a good investor or a good design engineer. In second scenario, you say it is also a wrong placement. This is not from designer. This is from factory, because factory is placing these pallets, or a customer is placing pallets which is blocking the air circulation. If you see first row, second row, third row, fourth row, it's excellent. So it will make sure that air is going through this and it should return back. But in fifth row, the pallets are placed in such a manner that air is going here and air is not circulating through the last pallet. And this will not cool the last pallet, and it will make sure that last pallet will be not uniformly cooled or not at all cooled. And then your customer or your whoever rented your cold store, in case it is rented, will face the difficulties and he will say that your cold store is not of a good quality. So make sure your placement of the evaporators is properly done. Again, I got pop up. Yeah. Now the second thing is this placement is excellent. For example, if you see here, air is going through the pallets, there is a proper distance between pallets, and air is going and it will return back like this. Air will circulate, and at the top right hand corner, if you see, the air is going and it is coming back through the pallets, and you ensure that circulation is well managed. Now this is another way this is few projects I have done recently. So this was evaporators, and below it was a blast freezing and also a pre-cooling room where you place the evaporators and you make sure that air is circulated through the product and this rack is closed. Air is only traveling like this. We are making sure that air as a fluid should go through all the pallets. So we get 100% of thermodynamic effect in our product. Now, on top right hand side, if you can see, there is a air circulation model mentioned, which is for a floor mounted evaporator. So air is forced through the product, and then we have a flap here. We make sure that air is circulated back. So ultimately, what we wanted to conclude here, we wanted to say that we have to make sure air is stupid. Air should be guided. Air is not smart enough that it will decide himself or herself, whatever gender you say air is, that it should go through the product with her own intelligence. It is our intelligence which will help to make sure that air must circulate through the product. I get one more pop-up. Now, next point is the sound level. Sound level is important. Some of the cases, sound level is so important, and some of the cases, for example, if you have a freezer room which remain always closed. In my slide, if you can see, it is just showing examples of sound level. For example, if you see at the bottom, you go for morning walk early in the morning, you have say around 10 decibel of sound. Yeah, then if you are in living room, you are watching a TV, comfortably it is around 40 decibel. Yeah, then you go higher in an office, you have a 50 to 60 decibel. So, you know, this is just to give you an example that how much, what is the sound and how it is related to human beings. So in normal cases, cold stores, sound not matter a lot. If it is a freezer store, you will put the product inside and you close the door. Even you have a 110 decibel, it will not make any difference. So this is my personal opinion. The sound decibel will not make any big impact for a cold store or chilled product store or blast freezer. Yes. But if you have a humans working there, for example, you have a cold store with fruit and vegetable sorting area, where vegetables and fruits are coming and you are sorting them, you are separating rotten products, or you are separating some, you know, about to rotten product, and humans are working there, then I will not suggest you to go above 60 decibel. That is the limit I'll suggest you. Yeah. Rest, you know what you have to do. Now the second, next point is defrost. So once your room is at the temperature around 0 degrees Celsius or below, your evaporators tend to deposit some frost. And frost, if it is not properly defrosted, it turns out to be ice. And once it becomes ice, I bet, you know, we have done case studies. So this ice will give you a lot of electricity bills. And this ice will make sure that your efficiencies goes down maybe up to 30%. And then one day you check your bills and you say, my electricity bill has increased with same machinery, same everything. What is the problem? So this is because of defrost is not proper. I have seen some of the defrost in cold stores in India, that people are having ice, but they say, no, sir, evaporator is running fine. We have very good room temperature. So I always, you know, go to owners and tell them, sir, please make sure your technicians, they should be trained. Because having a technician like a watchman, which having a pistol without bullets, a technician with the attitude can change and make sure your electricity bill should be less. But if you have a technician just to, you know, for your satisfaction, your personal satisfaction, who does not know what he is doing, it is also not good. Because this technician, what I am sharing with you, was very happy. He was happy to see that evaporator is building ice, so evaporator is working fine. But he was not able to realize that because of this ice buildup, or the owner or the investor is getting high bills. And also, as an evaporator supplier myself, my efficiency of evaporator goes down, and the electricity bill and the rated current or rated power consumption will always go high. So it is also not good for me. Now, defrost, normally in what I have done in my life, say 90% of the cases, I am big fan of hot gas defrost, and I love hot gas defrost. Maybe because say 90% of the projects I have done from, or rather 85%, I have done with ammonia only. That is the reason we use hot gas defrost, which is very, very efficient. We save a lot of power comparison to electrical defrost. But in some cases where electrical defrost is essential and we cannot avoid that, so electrical defrost is also efficient, because ultimately it is a designer prerogative. He has to find out that which defrost system will suit the project. Because every defrost system has certain advantages and certain disadvantages with respect to the design and the cold store we are going to build. Now, to be very frank, water defrost, this I learned around 7 years back for cold stores. Because in Middle East, normally for cold stores, we never use water defrost. Because we feel that it is very unhygienic. Yeah. And also we feel that water will always spoiling evaporators. And after some time, water quality is not been taken care. And so it will create a lot of issues with evaporator. And of course, water defrost, I have seen in many installations in Middle East, only for IQF, only for spiral freezers, where we have you know, daily washing of these IQFs or spiral freezers, or even blast freezers. But these are fully stainless steel. But normal fruit, vegetable, cold stores, and also freezer rooms or chilled rooms, I have not seen water defrost in Middle East area. Yes, the fourth, which is also important defrost system, we call it air defrost, where we are using existing air and high speed of air sometime. For example, we are shifting air speed from low to high just to defrost the evaporator. And this is not for the evaporator which is below zero or close to zero. Say, this is not used widely in this part of the world. Now, next is, I get pop-up, yes. Now comes accessories for the evaporators. You may choose insulated drip tray or non-insulated evaporators, covered bands, hinge drip tray, hinge fan plate, suction hood. For example, suction hood, you can see at the top right corner. For me, these are very important. To tell you, we have experienced a lot of power saving in big cold stores where we have provided suction hoods, because when evaporator goes in defrost, so the heat of evaporator is not coming out, and that ensure there are some power saving in the evaporator. I mean, not for the evaporator, for the cold store. Then we have a SOC connections, depending upon, normally it is used in a processing area. Then some cases, if you have a pre-cooling, then you have a tilted fan. If you have a room freezer room temperature, say minus 22 and below, I would always suggest fan ring heaters. In fact, if you can afford, go with the minus 20 and below fan ring heaters. Because I have also experienced there is ice buildup on the fan because a lot of humidity entering into the distribution centers. And then there is ice buildup on the fan blades. So fan blades, they become imbalanced, and at the end it will, they are broken. This I have seen at many, many installations in India. And then customer want a fan replacement from the contractor, but customer will never admit his mistake that his defrost was not proper, his curtains were not proper. So as an engineer, as a designer, as a contractor, as a project salesperson, you have to make sure these points are very important, and they will help you to connect with your end customer, owners and investors. So fan ring heaters are important. Then anti-condensation heater, this is also on fan motor. Then filters on evaporators, this normally used in some of the areas where you have some dirt coming in. For example, I know in poultry areas where you have stored chicken, and the chicken feathers are coming back and stuck in evaporators. So you make sure that there are some filters before air entering there. So that ensure that your feathers and all whatever impurities or particles should not get stuck there. Now, later on, you have at the last, you have some fin or material where you have epoxy coated fins, stainless steel fins, or copper tubes and copper fins also. For example, in ships, we are using copper tubes and copper fins, stainless steel tubes and stainless steel fins in certain processing area. And so material plays also important role. So here complete the accessories of evaporator. Now we have compressor, we have evaporators. So I would say for this cold store, my plant room, it looks like this. This is typical flooded pump ammonia or HFC. Yes, even you can pump HFC also. Yeah, in case you are in city limits and your municipality regulations is not allowing you to put ammonia, and then you can have a HFC refrigerant also in a pump. So because we have a six rooms working as either as a chilled operation or as a frozen product operation. So for that, what I will prefer? I will prefer one compressor, which will cater to entire cold store as a freezer application, and one compressor as entire cold store as a chiller operation. And then I will be having one compressor as a standby. A standby compressor will be working as a swing. In case you have some problem with any of the compressors, because I have to also consider input which I get from my investor, that he may be storing say 20 million euro worth of product inside cold store, and my refrigeration and cold store project total including panel is not more than 2.5 million euro. So I will make sure I will give him a standby compressor, so his products will always remain secure. So I always tell in my trainings that cold storage is like a central bank where a lot of wealth is deposited, and you have to make sure that you put all the safeties so these wealth stays, this money stays protected, and this money stays intact, and this money stays, you know, the way it should be. So there is I will put two evaporative condensers, or even one is okay, and I will put one high pressure receiver, and I have a minus 28 separator because I am going for minus 22 freezer rooms and a chilled rooms from 10 degrees Celsius to minus 3. So minus 3 normally for garlic storage, and then minus 3 to plus 15, this is fruit and vegetable cold storage range. So this will be typical my plant room. Now let's see what. So your customer may also say that he want to have a banana store or banana ripening chamber, you know, where you have a different set of engineering, but it is you know, nothing different than what we have done. So banana ripening, normally this part of the world we are using dual discharge evaporators. Yeah, in fact India also I have seen some excellent banana ripening rooms where people are very, very professional doing banana ripening and banana cooling. And then ice cream storage. Yes, I had many customers in India and around for ice cream storage. In fact, I have a customer in Pakistan. So he stores a particular ice cream which should be stored at minus 28 degrees Celsius. So these kind of ice creams, your investor should tell you, or your or as a designer or as a project sales guy or as a contractor, you have to make sure that what your customer actually looking for. So you are going to have vision for him. Now next is a cheese storage. So cheese storage is very critical. We always think that this is cheese or butter or anything, because they are there at very low humidity. You know, cheese and chocolate stores, I think cheese stores I have not done, but yes, chocolate store I have done. So chocolate store, when I have done first time, so this is around 40 to 50% RH and awesome designing procedure. And that was a good learning for me. Vegetable and fruit store, you can store in a different way. You have a pallets, you have a racks, you can put inside humidifiers, and you make sure that you maintain 90% plus RH for most of the fruits and vegetable. And then you have certain investors, they will always say that one of the room which is universal room or a champion room or an all-rounder room, this room should be provided with the ability so he can pre-cool the fruits or vegetable, or he can blast freeze, or he can do any multiple operation. So you have to make sure asking all these questions. Then we have other accessories which we are using in these kind of cold stores. For example, ice machines are also used. you have fans. For example, in some cases, we have normal evaporators in our cold stores, especially in these kind of distribution centers. And we try to have additional fans. For example, if we have a normal room and then we have to use that normal room as a pre-cooling room or as a pre-chilling room, then we need additional fans which we can use as a booster fans to make sure that these fans can generate high pressure to change that room from a normal room to pre-cooling room. And then we should have humidifiers. Humidifiers are required in rooms where you are storing products where you need high humidity. And dehumidifier also, for example, if you have chocolate stores, you have cheese stores, or you have spices or dry products, so you need dehumidifiers also. So you cannot always dry products from evaporators only. Yes, you can play around with evaporators, but not all the time. I don't know why I got stuck here. Let me check. Yes. So another thing is you have various automations you can use. I think this is not a new thing. You know, normally customer want, he can see on his computer distribution center. So what is the temperature going on? Like I know one of my customer in Qatar, he was traveling a lot and he had a house in France. So most of the time he was staying in France and then he was able to see what temperatures and for example, dates. So dates require a particular temperature and humidity levels. So he wanted to make sure that he is able to serve his customer, which were some cases were very, very, you know, high-end customers. So they want a data logging report for 2 or 3 months of storage. So in that case, you should have a data loggers and, you know, things like that. Then you have a separator vessels, which you design carefully, whether you have HFC refrigerant or ammonia as a refrigerant, they should be properly designed. And for condensation, now we have seen compressors, evaporators, and third comes is a condenser. So condenser is, you can have evaporative condensers, you can have a cooling tower with shell and tube condensers. You can have a combination of air-cooled condenser with evaporative condenser. One of the project I have come across and we have done is where customer was having scarcity of water. So we were using daytime condenser, which is used and driven by water, or it was a evaporative, the cooling principle was evaporative cooling. But during night time, the customer was using air-cooled condenser because night temperature was very lower. So like that, we have instrumentation. We have, you know, sometimes it is only a fruit and vegetable cold store, so we can use a glycol chiller also. But of course, this also had some advantages and disadvantages. So as a designer, we must understand what we are going to have. And the last and the most important here is isothermal product. You should have a good dock levelers. You should have good insulated panel. You should have good doors in your cold store. You should have, you know, highly efficient if you are using roll up or high speed doors or sectional doors. So the customer should get maximum benefit. So as a contractor, now you have the order, you have a challenge to have a detailed planning, resource management, and whatever contract analysis, because you have to make sure the customer should get what he deserves and what he pay for. And as a designer, as a project salesperson, you must ensure that you are giving him all the things black and white. And this is again coming back to plant room. And when your project is ready, you have a cold store, you have a plant room, and you have already cold store. So last but not the least, before handing over, you must have training to customer as a contractor or as a component supplier. For example, I am a compressor supplier. So if I would like to make sure that my customer stays educated and my customer should stay happy. So I will make sure that my contractor will conduct a proper training before handover, or as a evaporator supplier, or as a pump supplier, or insulated panel or door supplier, there should be a proper training given after the handover or along with the handover. So this is very important. So this we've been doing all the projects. So I think with that I end my presentation. I think it is are you able to see me? I think with this,
yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, with this I conclude. Now we have question and answers, and I would be happy, you can ask me anything, everything.
Yeah, we can take up the question one by one. It was a wonderful session. If anyone wants to get connected to Mr. Arun, these are the LinkedIn IDs and the numbers that you can see on screen. So please get a note of that. And now we'll take the questions one by one. If I will take the first question, which is written by Mr. Sunil, and he is asking that what is the difference of air changes between pre-cooling and blast room. So by mean, I think he's mean to ask that what is the difference between the air changes for the room pre-cooling and blast room. So can you, Mr. Arun, can you take up that?
Yeah. So this is good question. Say pre-cooling and blast freezers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, both have a similar air circulation ratio. For example, if I am pre-chilling curd, okay. So I will share one of the experience with us that we had a room where we had a very high pressure. So curd, which was in the packets, it was flying away. So air changes around 200 to 300 air changes will be there for blast as well as pre-chilling. So the air changes will always remain same. Only thing is the pressure will be different based on what product you have. For example, if you have a heavy product, you have a high pressure, or you have a bigger product, so you have a much more higher pressure. So I'm able to answer the question.
I hope Mr. Sunil, you can you are okay with the answer, and your doubt has been cleared. So we'll take up the next question. This is by Mr. Sunil Gautam. So he's asking that what is the static pressure range used for storage coolers and blast freezers? Are there any specific or special requirement also?
See, most of the manufacturers they are producing standard evaporators which are considered for specific air throw and specific air pressures. I'm talking standard evaporator, which ranges from 10 to 25 Pascal external static pressure. So these are standard evaporators, which are manufactured by most of the A standard evaporators. But for blast freezers, you must have external static pressure minimum from 50 Pascal, and maximum it goes up to maybe 250 Pascal. For example, if you have a small room and 50-60 kilowatt evaporator, so I'll go 50 to 100 Pascal external static pressure. And if you have a big room and say 10 to 15 ton of chicken, I have to freeze in 8 hours, then I'll go around 150 Pascal pressure of evaporators. So second case, it is more of a customized evaporator. First case, it is more of a standard evaporator. Am I able to answer?
I think Mr. Gautam is okay,
yes,
with that.
Thank you.
Yeah. And Mr. But yeah, I would like to take some, I would like to ask you to give few more lines on the guidelines if someone want to start learning the design of cold storage. So, what are the guidelines other than ESHRAE cold storage basics? What the guidelines and design manuals or operation manuals can he refer to so that he can start from the scratch? So it is a question by Mr. Rahul Rohit Verma. So if you can, if you want to address few more guidelines that other than ESHRAE cold room storage, what are the guidelines?
Rohit, I am glad you asked this question because see cold store, cold chain, if you see cold chain is a very, very important part in our daily life because it is connected to food security. And you are lucky that if you are able to work in this cold chain process. Now coming back to your question, how you can learn about this cold storages, design, engineering. So the first thing I would suggest you that is most important thing is our uncle Google. So you should Google sometime. It is you get some papers. Yeah. I am also posting some articles and some videos on my YouTube channel, which I have not mentioned here. Yeah, and I'm just trying to, you know, give some calculation or whatever I have learned. And other thing which I normally do, I have some mentors. See, I am still a student. If I have a doubt, I have mentors. I pick the phone, I call them, and I ask them questions. Or I have Zoom with them. I contact them on WhatsApp. So. Rohit, you should contact a mentor. You should have a mentor. Yeah, you cannot learn cold store design yourself. See, you can search on Google. You have some papers, but ultimately you will come across questions. So Google can give you a book, but understanding of that book can only be done through a proper mentor. So I always believe your mentor is mentor in the sense. देसी भाषा में हम ये बोल सकते हैं कि आपका उस्ताद, सो यू शुड ऑलवेज हैव अ मेंटर, गुरुजी, है ना? सो आपका गुरु, आपका मेंटर इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट. सो ऑलवेज ट्राई टू हैव मेंटर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, आई हैव 3-4 मेंटर्स, बट आई हैव अराउंड 15 मेंटीज विद मी. सो आई एम मेंटरिंग अराउंड 15 पीपल. सो यू शुड हैव somebody as a mentor. Who can help you?
Yeah. Otherwise, so Rohit, it is not a difficult.
It is not a difficult. It is very, very simple. Yeah. And we Indians are, you know, very, very intelligent people. And we can learn this. Ultimately, excellence comes through practice. So once you learn, you practice. So Rahul, like that, you can learn and later on you practice and you become excellent. Maybe one day you will be my mentor. You never know.
So Rohit, there's a direct message for you that you can get hold of Mr. Bhatia. He can be your mentor.
Oh, yeah,
and the
anytime.
Other question that comes out from the answer is, can you let us know your YouTube channel so some of the new people can follow you? You can just name it or if anyone wants to follow you.
Yeah, this is Training by AKB.
Training by AKB.
Yeah. So this is the channel, but I will. You can contact me on WhatsApp or phone or you know LinkedIn. I will give you that. Yeah. Because see, it is not about because when I'm sharing this thing from me, you will challenge me. So that will also help me to grow. So this is what I learn from my mentors that whatever you have, you try to. Put in front of others. So others will criticize you, they will scold you, they will give you feedback, and then this will help you to learn more.
Yes. So we will taking another two or more questions because we will be reaching close to our timeline, which is 7:30. So another question by Sunil is what do you suggest, a floor standing unit or a ceiling mounted unit for a blast room? So just quickly, one or two words on that. A floor mounted unit or a ceiling mounted unit for a blast room?
See, it depends on your product, but see, ceiling mounted and floor mounted, for me, it is not any difference. Okay, where the difference comes. For example, if you have a ceiling mounted evaporator, you cannot see the evaporator. Floor mounted, you can see. So in hygienic perspective, you are not able to access your ceiling mounted evaporator on daily basis. So if I have a cold store where technicians, I believe, will not be so trained and they will not look again and again at evaporator, so I will go ahead with a floor mounted. So ceiling mounted and floor mounted, in principle, in action, both are same, or in results. So both are same.
And what is the quick recommendation for temperature, humidity and storage pattern for onion and garlic cold storage? If you have personal experience on that, what will be the temperature and humidity recommended? This is a question by Mr. Ayush.
This I think most of the investors in India, they want to learn what is the ideal temperature, because onion and garlics are two commodities. I tell always to my customers that they are like gold. Yeah. So you import the garlic or you store the garlic, and same with thing with onion. But onion is not only with temperature and humidity, it is related to air circulation and, you know, lot of factors. So this question, I think for that we should have a separate session on onion and garlic cold stores. And it is not easy.
It can be a one-to-one session for onion and garlic.
Yeah, for example, we did 10,000 tons, two cold stores in Saudi Arabia. Their onion even goes up to, you know, as less as 50% RH or lesser than that. When you bring onions with high speed, you try to dry their, you know, bulbs. So this is one of the process there. Then you have a ventilation process. So onion, garlic, and these are money making things, and blast freezers. Rest all distribution centers, they are like, you know, like for me, they are normal, but onion, garlic, cold stores, these are like money making things. So as an investor, you are always keen, but otherwise, and even chocolate stores, yeah, spices stores. So that is not a question which can be, you know, answered in just 2 or 3 minutes. But again, you can get in touch with me by email or anything. We can, you know, conclude something.
So, Mr. Bhatia, are you okay to take last one more question? We can take another last question.
I have no problem. I can take, because for me, it's only going to be 6 here. Yeah. So I'm free. I'll go. I have a coffee at starting. Now I'll go have tea.
So the last question we'll be taking today is, it's by Mr. Sandeep Kumar. And for which capacity we can put ammonia cold storage or freon application? So how we can differentiate between ammonia cold storage and freon cold storage depending on the capacity?
So, you know, this is a very good question. I remember 22 years back when I was, sorry, I want to give some anecdote with this question. So I can make sure I will explain it properly. So that time I was selling only freon systems. So we used to scare people that ammonia systems are not good. Yeah. So after working in industry, now I'll say that whether you have an ammonia system or non-ammonia system, if your designer is good, both systems are good. Now coming back to question. What capacity we should consider for ammonia and freon system? So it is more than important, you know, question is, most important question is not capacity, it is operation also, and your municipality regulation also. For example, if you want to start a cold store inside the city, so it should not be ammonia, correct? And but as a thumb rule, I will say around, if anything, freezer application above 500 kilowatt, it is always good to go with ammonia. Always good to go with ammonia. But if you have a smaller, You know, you can go with alternate refrigerant or glycol or anything. But most important is where you are installing your cold store. But my recommendation is ammonia is a better refrigerant because it saves a lot of power. And it is very safe. People say it is not safe. It is very safe. So am I able to answer my your question? Hello?
I think he's yeah, he can. I think he's okay with it. So Sandeep, I hope it is clear for you. So Mr. Bhatia, this is it. I think we are not receiving any more questions. So I will request you to make a request on behalf of Ishre Gurugram chapter to be a part of Ishre. If you can do just one or two lines, that would be being your senior member. So it would be great if you can influence someone to join Ishre. That would be great for the membership and for the society and people like us.
I always tell people it is always good to have clubs, any kind of clubs where you can learn. And if you go back to our Indian history, our intellect was always with sharing and caring. So Ishre is an organization, Ishre is a group where like-minded people comes together and they share their knowledge. I will always recommend that as a young engineer or as an experienced designer, you must join organization like Ishre or others, so you can share your knowledge and you can learn. Yeah, Ishre, I have experience. I mean, in even Gurugram chapter, there are some excellent people. I mean, some are really, really, you know, good friends. For example, a chapter president Sanjay Hans, yeah, and Sunil Gautam. They are really, really nice people. I know them personally. I mean, having said that, I'm not saying they are not, others are not nice, but these two I know them personally. Yeah, so I should make my, you know, what I said clear. But I would suggest, request everyone to join Ishre. It is always good. And come together, stay together and share knowledge. Yeah. And anybody want to get connected to me for anything, you are always welcome. And also one more thing I want to say, that I get at least 100 messages in my WhatsApp, because I shared some from Africa that they are not able to get in. I don't know, they were facing some problems. And one of my friend from Gurgaon, I don't know he is online or not, Satish Dhankar, he sent me a personal message that his team members are not able to connect because there was some technical glitch. There is Srinivas Dairy, Hyderabad. There is somebody who sent me a message that he is not able to get connected because of technical glitch. But I can understand that this is always happening. Yeah. And I suggest we can have a similar session again in any of the chapters, yeah, where we can learn, or we can have even discussions where we can have question answers or like group discussions. So I learn something from you also, especially from Sanjay. Great.
Yeah. Unfortunately, Sanjay could not join us because he was trying. He was also having a similar problem. But Mr. Gautam is here with us. So, Mr. Gautam, would you like to say a few words? And I would say thanks to Mr. Bhatia. So he has taken a time for us, and it's been extraordinary presentation by him. So, Mr. Gautam, are you there? Can you speak few words and give a vote of thanks to Mr. Bhatia?
Yes, Bhavya. Thank you so much. And Mr. Bhatia, thank you so much, sir. It's a really useful session. We learned a lot, and I could see from the questions and answers that participants were really involved, and the topic was very useful. Cold store design from bare land to the project delivery. So it connected very well, I believe, with everyone. And for everyone's benefit, for the people who attended as well as the people, there were many who couldn't attend or who like dropped out due to some technical issues. So the recorded session will be uploaded on the YouTube. And once again, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thanks everybody for joining in. We'll keep on sharing such future sessions in future at Ishire Gurgaon. And thank then you. We'll see.
My pleasure. God bless you all. Thank you, Executive Committee, Gurugram Ishire. I wish you all the best for future. And I also request you to share this recording with me. So I will also upload on, my YouTube channel.
Thank you, sir. You being the host, sir, you have to take care of that like while relieving. So please.
Okay. Actually,
you can transfer the hosting to me. Yeah, I'm Ishire Gurugram by the name of Ishire Gurugram.
Even I was not knowing because I have also a Zoom account for 100 participants. Otherwise, okay, but it is fine. And I think we can have a. But I learned a lot of things like, this handover and all. So I am not a techie guy, yeah? Especially with this. But last 3 months only I learned this Zoom and all.
And definitely, sir, we are much better. We are much better now than we were at beginning.
We are improving in this lockdown.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you all for joining us, and a special thanks to Mr. Bhatia. Special thanks to all the participants who had joined. Thank you very much, and keep connected to Ishire Gurugram chapter or Ishire, where anywhere you are. So be the member. You can also contact directly on LinkedIn and Facebook to Mr. Bhatia or to Ishire Gurugram. I am Bhavya Jain. I also written the details. If you want to join as a member, you can join and stay connected. Please follow us. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bhatia, and thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Take care. Stay safe. Thank you. Bye.